you know, we were created to worship God. And people say, oh, you know, worship isn't just about singing and playing. It. Worship is a whole entire life. Well, yes, that's true. You know, but to me, worship is my relationship with God.
Amen.
And I know that everybody comes from a different walk of life. We've all walked through different things. And I grew up in a Christian home. My parents were pastors. So I always felt like I didn't have this grand testimony because I wasn't in the gutter. I wasn't doing drugs. I wasn't doing all of that stuff. So I was like, well, what do I have to share? Because it's not what, you know, I didn't feel like my testimony was going to be what brought someone to Christ because I grew up sheltered and I grew up, that's how I did. But I guess because I was a pastor's kid, the things that they walked through in their ministry fell on me. Not because they meant for it to, but just we walked through. My mom was a worship leader, and we were in this church, and they went through a very difficult time where my dad confronted the head pastor about some sin that was going on in his life, and because of that, they shoved us out of the church, and they sent us and said, oh, well, you know, this church in Kentucky that we're related to, they need a new pastor, so why don't y'all go there? So they kicked us out, and so that, my parents felt such rejection and such, you know, animosity from the people that they called their family. And that just fell on me and my brother and sister. And not because they wanted it to, but it just happened. And so I have grown up, even starting with that, just feeling rejected all the time. I didn't have many friends growing up. I would have a friend, like one or two, and then something would happen and they would just throw me to the wayside. And so my testimony has been about the rejection that has followed me my entire life, and me being in the church my entire life. And I'm gonna gather my thoughts for a minute here. In and out of school, I went to a Christian school, but I always felt alone, always. Felt alone. And I know Jeff mentioned, you know, you might feel that you're, I always knew that I was set to a higher standard, that I was different than everybody else. I was called to something different.
Yeah.
And because of that, it made me feel even more alone. So the only person that I had to turn to was Jesus. Because I knew that He was always there for me. A lot of people say, well, I don't understand the love of God. I don't feel the love of God. And that's hard for me because Jesus was all that I ever had. He was the only person that I knew loved me. I mean, my parents, I knew that they loved me and I never had troubles with them or anything like that. But just always alone in church, always alone in life, always alone in school. And so I just knew that even at in the bottom of my rope, that God was all that I had. And when we came back to Jacksonville and got involved in this other church my family did, I was 12 years old, I went to my first youth meeting. And it was a small group of people. We were just sitting around, and I had was saved, I was filled with the Holy Spirit, but I was still missing that one-on-one connection with the Lord, that deep, intimate relationship that you need to have with Him. And so they had shared the message, and there was a lady there who started playing the guitar, and she just sang a song by herself. And it was like in that moment, the Lord met me. And I just knew, I was like, wow, there is so much more than what I have been feeling my entire life. And I just, that was like the start for me of my personal relationship with God. And so I began to know, like, okay, I have a talent. I can sing. I enjoy worship. I love worship. But we started going to this church, and it was the pastor that we had for the worship leading. He's like, oh, yeah, you have a great talent. You should sing and come and sing in the choir. And I was like, oh, okay, cool. Like, someone recognizes me a little bit, right? So then, this is a guy who plays with the likes of Don Moen and Paul Wilbur and leads crusades in other countries, and he plays 16 instruments, and he's always talking about excellence. And it's like, here comes this, you know, 14, 15 year old girl who's like starting to feel like you have a passion to lead worship and to do stuff like that, and you're like, okay, well, where do I fit? You know, because they're like, oh, well, you sang a little flat on this key, you know, or you were a little off on this song, so you're not quite ready. And it's like, well, who's to tell you that you're not ready or that you're not right for the job? So, you know, trying to fit into that, you should come and sing in the ensemble, which is you get to hold a mic. You know, everybody else is in the choir and they're standing back here, but I'm going to put you in the ensemble. And he had me go to one of the other girls and say that I was going to be her replacement. So I was the one that had to go and do that. So you come into this, it was like religion, but I didn't understand that it was religion. Mm-hmm. And so it's the constant, I'm not good enough, I don't have what it takes, I have this passion inside of me and this desire to worship God, but they had turned it into what worship is, it's just part of the service, so you have to do it, right? But it was not, they were losing the simplicity of it all. Mm-hmm. That worship is not about entertaining people.
Right.
It is about you and the Lord.
Yes.
And so I spent years in that and going back and forth and really wanting to be the person on stage holding the mic because I knew that I had something to give people, but not understanding what it was inside of me that I had to give. Mm-hmm. And we were involved with the young adult group of our church, and Jeff was talking to our leader for the young adults, who is also a worship leader, and they were having like a little coffee meeting one day, and he told Jeff, Raina will never be a worship leader. She doesn't have what it takes.
Wow.
And I don't know why Jeff told me that after the meeting, but it crushed all of my hopes and my dreams. Mm-hmm. Because once again, I was alone, and once again, I was being told I wasn't enough. I wasn't good enough to share Christ how I knew to share Christ, and that was through worship. Mm-hmm. And so then life took us elsewhere, and we ended up with Pastor Rick in Oasis. And Jeff was like, and I wasn't going to jump in and be like, hey, I like to sing, can I join the praise team? And Jeff was like, Pastor Rick, you know, Ray sings. So I ended up on, you know, singing with them, and I started learning because it wasn't about two fast songs and a slow song and let's jump into announcements. It was about let's listen to the Spirit and hear what the Spirit is saying. Because at the old church, the Spirit would start to move. And our pastor would get up on the stage and say, all right, let's have a little fireside chat, just in case anybody's afraid of what's happening. And immediately the Spirit would be
gone.
He would not even stop long enough to let people.
People couldn't even get up to the front.
They couldn't get up to the front. They couldn't be ministered to. There was no freedom. There was none. So I come in to the Oasis where they have hour and a half long worship sets. And I was like, man, I was so excited. I was like, this is how you do worship here? This is amazing. So, you know, I got into that, and I was able to just really, really learn what it meant to worship and what worship was all about. And it wasn't all the seminars and the this is how you're supposed to do it and this is how it's supposed to be. And you sing one verse and one chorus and one bridge and you're done, you know? So I guess that's my testimony.
Amen.
So then I began to grow in the Oasis. And then all of a sudden, Pastor Rick was like, hey, I think you should be the worship leader. And I was like, what?
Right.
I am not qualified. You know, that's what you think. I'm not, how do I do that? What do you do? But I just knew that it was time because it was like, I was always looking and being like, oh, one day maybe I'll be on stage in front of, you know, thousands of people, and maybe one day I'll go on tour, and maybe one day Jeff will be doing crusades, and I'll be the worship, you know, but it just, like, we got to the Oasis, and I learned, and it was like, that wasn't important anymore.
Yeah.
It wasn't important. So, when I think about worship, obviously everybody thinks about David, right? And so what everybody thinks that to be a worship leader, you have to have everything together. Well, I can tell you that I am the least put together person you have ever met. My mind and my heart are a crazy mess half the time. I've got two boys that I chase around, and it's like I barely have time to put 10 minutes together to like think about the Lord in a day, you know. But what I love about David, and Pastor Rick and I have talked about this, is that he was just real. He was, you're reading Psalms, and it's like in one chapter, he's like, great are you, Lord. You created the heavens and the earth, and you are grand. And then in the next one, he's like, Lord, why are you not killing my enemies? You know? So I love that because I can, looking at that, I know that I can go and sit. Like just a couple weeks ago, I was in the office and I was just like, I need to play the guitar for a little bit. I probably should be responsible and like practice my gift, right? So I'm sitting there and I'm just playing, and I just started pouring my heart out to the Lord, and it was nothing happy. It was everything sad. And it was everything like, woe is me. I am terrible. I have nothing. I'm alone. Like, it was all of that stuff. But the presence of the Lord came in that room. Mm-hmm. And it was because I was real. Amen. And that is what worship is. It's you and the Lord and everything that's in your heart, good and bad, poured out to Him. Mm-hmm. That is what worship is. Mm-hmm. It's not the entertainment. It's not someone else's version of worship. It's so easy to be like, hear someone singing, be like, oh, I want to sound like that. So you try to like copy the riffs as they sing them and like and do that. And it, like, that is not it.
No.
Like, I've come to a place where I don't even know why I'm up there. Like, I just know that that's my time with the Lord. And I don't care who's out here. I just know that, all right, this is my time to sing. And I hope that people, when I'm singing and I'm giving my heart to God, that they are able to capture that for themselves.
Yes.
And then take that moment. So I'm not up there so that you can see me. I'm up there so that you can sit in that seat and close your eyes and say, all right, Lord, here I am. I am. I've had a really crappy day. Yes. But I know that you're going to meet me here where I'm at. Yes. You know, or things are great, God. You have just been so faithful to me. And you're just praising Him. So, people, I mean, I've really gotten away from the fact I don't want to entertain. I just know that I need to be with God because He's my life. Yeah. And He's what keeps me going. And I'm not alone when I have Him.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
I'm not alone. So, what else? I know I have more, but
So I have a question.
Okay.
So what about when you don't feel like it?
Oh, that's a good question.
Mm-hmm.
That is something that if I ever know that God is faithful, it's on a Sunday morning.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm telling you that I will go through my week, and you know, people that have kids, or even if you don't have kids, you understand, you get busy. I don't have 2 seconds to think. Those 9 and 4 year old run around, mommy, 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 mommy. I'm like, you know? So we'll get to Sunday morning, 9:30, service starts at 11, and I'm looking at Pastor Rick like, I ain't got nothing. I don't know what songs we're gonna sing. Anybody got any ideas? You know, and so then I scramble together, I pull some stuff together. You know, we start our practice, and practice is terrible. Nobody knows what chord goes where. And, well, wait, how do you get into the bridge? And I'm like, we've been playing together for almost 10 years. 10 years, and you cannot, we've done this song 100 times. And so I am just like, so at that moment, I am just like, okay, Lord. And I just start playing, and we just get started. And I just go through the motions, and then all of a sudden, it happens. The Lord just comes. Because people at that time, they want to give up.
Mm-hmm.
They're like, there was a day that I think Jeff and I had gotten into a huge fight before church, and I was leaving to go to church, and it's like, you know, who wants to lead worship when you feel so crappy? Mm-hmm. And so I was in tears half of the practice. And nobody knew. I just was going, and so we started and I just kept saying to myself, though, I don't want to do this. I don't want to do this right now. I can't do it. I don't. And so that was that moment that I was like, okay, Lord, I really don't want to do this, but I'm going to praise you. And I just started singing, and I wasn't feeling it. And I just kept singing, still wasn't feeling it. By the second song, the Holy Spirit had come into me.
Yeah.
And I just got it. He touched my life. He met me right where I was at, like he always is faithful to do. And it always blows my mind.
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean?
So I mean, it's like, it's almost like that every Sunday. I mean, I think I might one week out of every 6 weeks, get a list of songs during the week and know the direction that the Lord wants to go in, and everything's together, but the rest of the time I'm never together. And I just know that God is faithful, and he shows up every time, and I say, okay, Lord, this is my meager offering. It doesn't feel right to me, but what is the point?
Mm-hmm.
My heart is right.
Amen.
My heart is right. My heart's desire is to worship the Lord. My heart's desire is to have my one-on-one time with him and to praise him and to lift him higher. And because I'm doing that, he is honored, he is glorified, and so he comes. Because he knows he's welcome, he knows he's wanted, he knows he's desired.
Mm-hmm.
And that is, I mean, gosh, every breath I take, all I want to do is to love the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
All I want to do is to praise the Lord. Even when I don't feel like it, I know that I can be like, God, I am hurting, but he is right there.
Mm-hmm.
He loves me. I am my beloved's. He's mine.
Yes.
And that means so much to me, because worship is intimacy.
Mm-hmm.
It's not about everybody else. Worship to me is just God. It's mm-hmm. just Jesus. It's mm-hmm. simple. It's my connection with him. That's all I want to do
mm-hmm.
when I'm up here. And we used to stand on the stage mm-hmm. at Oasis, and I was just like, this isn't right. Like, I'm not here for people to look at me. So we changed everything around,
mm-hmm.
and now I stand over here.
Yep, off to the side.
I don't even, mm-hmm. I'm not in front of the people, and I feel like it's like this big circle, because
mm-hmm.
that's what
mm-hmm.
we should be. Mm-hmm. Everybody's equal.
Mm-hmm.
I almost wanted to be like, I don't even want to say, I want to stand this way and worship the Lord. Because
mm-hmm.
this is, you know, I mean, not that God is right here and only in that direction. You know?
It's so awesome.
Another, I know Pastor Joyce wanted you to talk about a little bit about the prophetic, but it's hard for me because I just kind of walked into that. Like, I wasn't involved in any of that at our old church because, like I said, they didn't give time for the Spirit to move. We just sang the songs and we were done. So when we came here, we came to the Oasis and people were singing prophetically, and I was like, wow.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it blew my mind. What does that mean? That's what he asked me. What does that mean? So I didn't even know how. So I think that what led me into that is being around people who knew how to do that helped me learn
mm-hmm.
how to do it. But also being in an environment where you're encouraged, you're free
yes.
to, you know, and they weren't like, oh, you have to sound like this and you have to say that. It's just like, what is the Lord saying to you? Just sing it. Just do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And I think that mm-hmm. to me, I'm not a big, like some, like Jeff, he, or even Bill Dickerson, I know he was here, right?
Mm-hmm.
He looks at a person and he sees their entire life.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't prophesy like that.
Mm-hmm.
I get, like, I see words in my head and I just know, okay, that's the Lord. And so it's a very easy, like, just a simple,
mm-hmm.
and I don't get stuff all the time. So to me, prophecy, singing prophecy is no different than just walking up to somebody and prophesying to them in word, like, just talking. So I will be singing, and a lot of times when we're picking songs and not meaning to, they are hitting they're singing to the people or like ministering to the people where they are at.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't plan for it to happen, but it's just that's where we are at as a church, and they need to be ministered to that way. And so I just know, well, I'm dealing with this stuff right now, so I know that they're dealing with it too. And then the Lord just begins to speak to me. So I just sing out what he gives me. And it doesn't sound right all the time. It doesn't always hit the right note or hit the right chord, but I just know I have to be obedient, because even if it's wrong, the Lord's anointing it, so it's going to hit who it needs to hit at the right time.
Mm-hmm. Amen. So, that's good.
Yeah. Any other questions? I know there was something else I was going to say, and it flies away really quick.
Well, when you were just talking, and this is what I like, is that, and this is what I'm getting out of what you're sharing, is that because you allow the presence of the Lord to come in and take over, then his voice comes through you, through the prophetic, for the whole body. Instead of it just being about a person, it ends up being even about a move. I tried to pick up some of the stuff that you were saying yesterday. I had her start a little bit sooner live because the words that were coming prophetically were amazing. And I knew they weren't just for River of Life. They needed to go out to the people that were listening and wanted to listen. And so what I'm seeing and what I've experienced watching and being part of it, just since you've been here, is that all of a sudden when you start to do this, that the Holy Spirit just, it's like an explosion of an atomic bomb that goes off and you see the smoke come out. But before that, if you're watching in the camera, you see the ripple, and the ripple starts to come before the comes.
Yeah,
it's pretty amazing.
It's, I mean, a lot of times I get one or two like single words, and so I just start singing those. And as I start singing them, I know that it's a download that just comes. And so I just keep going with it because I don't have it in my head already. And there are times that it's kind of weird. It's just, you know, I'll give time for like at the end of a song. I want to give time for the Lord to minister if he has extra stuff that's not just the song. So I'll sing a few things and I just try to wait and see if I hear anything. And, you know, so it's easy to just, I can just sing stuff, but it's not always God. You know, but it's okay because I want to give him a chance, you know, to come through. And then sometimes, like, stuff like that doesn't happen all the time.
Mm-hmm.
But when it does, it's so powerful.
Mm-hmm.
And it has nothing to do with me at all. Like, it's just, I'm like, whoa, where did that come from? You know, but something else that we lately that has been happening is that I want to give more time for silence. And I'm not talking about like, I'm just talking about not singing. We're still playing, but because you can't always hear the Lord. And so sometimes I get frustrated because with the people around us, I'm sitting there just playing because I want to listen and hear what God might want to say. And everybody else is still singing. And I'm just like, shh, be quiet. Just listen. Because if you don't take a minute, you're going to miss.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yes,
sir. Yes, sir. Over here, right. A man in the blue man's t-shirt that says "Unsalted."
Yes. Perfect. Perfect. That's. And I lost my train of thought. I was playing. It was important. And in the Book of Psalm, you see many times in David's writing, and he writes a lot of times to his worship leader. I don't know if you realize that. If you just read the caption up top of the psalm before it says, "And this is to the." To the leader, you know, and so on, and tells his name. Just read it, just see it. Because he's instructing. Everything he wrote was to be sang in the sanctuary, in the congregation. And then he would give instruction as a conductor. And he would say some words, and all of a sudden, in the middle of it, it says, Selah. Mm-hmm. You've seen it. Well, we've been taught, okay, well, let me stop and think about it. Mm-hmm. But it's so deep, what she said, the silence. He wants the singers shut up and listen now, because you're going to get revelation of what you just sang.
Amen.
You're going to get the revelation if you just listen and allow the instruments. And that term Selah is improvisation on the instruments. And that instruments talk to God now. Mm-hmm. While you listen. While you listen. And the instruments are talking. So sometimes don't be bored when you hear some person playing their instrument. Listen. Mm-hmm. Listen. Because God is speaking through that. Because God is music. Mm-hmm. God is song. He even sings over songs of deliverance. You do know that.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus sang. You do know that, right?
Mm-hmm.
On his way to the garden that night. After all he'd been through, had the Last Supper, now knowing what he's about to face, and yet he felt the need to sing.
Mm-hmm.
I would love to know what song he sang.
God,
I would love to know. But remember, Selah, that's what she said. The Selah moment. That's what it means.
Well, and the other thing I was hearing, and where you started, was everything begins with brokenness.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're not going through something, I think brokenness, but it doesn't just stop there, overcoming. Because that also when you were talking, I was hearing how you overcame.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's where the song comes from.
Yeah.
And then when you got somebody up there that has had that experience and is truly broken, then that's where the worship place of worship comes from.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
I want to say, well, we had maybe 4 weeks ago, I was doing my weekly thing, like trying to think about songs, but I couldn't come up with anything. And finally, I guess it was Saturday, I texted Pastor Rick and I said, I got nothing. And he was like, good. And I was like, because I had this desire in my heart to bring to the Lord more than what we had been bringing to Him. And it's like, you know, we have all these songs, but I didn't write them, you know. But, and there's sometimes that you just don't have the words. And what these people are bringing is great and it's anointed, but it is not right. It's not it. And so I said, these words aren't enough. And he was like, well, now that you say that, because the Lord just spoke to me and he said, you know, don't prepare anything. You just need to be concerned with what key the Lord wants to sing it. And so I came to church the next day. I didn't prepare anything. We got there and he said, hey, I'd like to do these two songs. And I said, two songs? Okay, that's great. We normally do six. So we just started. And we let the Lord, we had those times of silence, and we just let the Lord minister through our silence and not talking, and we let the Lord give us songs that we started to sing, because it's all about a new song. Mm-hmm. It's all about what's in your heart to come out, because what's in your heart is what's going to minister to somebody else. And that was so, it's like changed our worship life at the Oasis. It changed our mind's eye of what worship should be like. And we were always like, oh, we should write our own songs and we should do it. And I have like the start of like 50 songs that I have not finished. You know, and I do get some songs while we're playing that I will, you know, continue to sing at with certain things, but the Lord wants to hear the new stuff.
Yes.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
Sing a new song. And I just can't reiterate enough how important it is that you not compare yourself to other people.
Mm-hmm.
And think that just because someone has a good voice or they play the guitar really well or play the keyboard really well, we talked about this too, that does not make them anointed.
Oh,
that's right.
Yeah. Okay. And so we had this conversation and it was a great revelation to me because Pastor Rick said, well, what's anointed? And I was just like, I don't have an answer to that. I don't know, because I grew up being taught in the religious church that you have to have a bachelor's or master's degree in music, you have to play at least 3 instruments, and your voice has to do this.
Mm-hmm.
And that's anointed. But that's not it.
No.
Because the Lord will move. He will move through people that are talented and really good at stuff, and His Spirit will fall, but that doesn't make them anointed. You know, and so we said, well, what is it? And he said, it's truth. So the Lord is his eyes are searching for those who worship in spirit and truth.
Mm-hmm.
So is your heart right?
Right.
What's in your heart that's coming out? Is it in truth? Then you're anointed. You don't sing on key, but your heart is right.
Right.
You're anointed.
Right.
What you have from the Lord at that moment is for someone else, and it's anointed because it's going to break chains, it's going to bring deliverance, it's going to heal.
Mm-hmm.
And we all have that inside of us because God created every single person to worship Him.
Mm-hmm.
That is why we were created.
Yes.
And I mean, like, how can you just walk outside, you, the person that you are, and without even saying anything, you worship God because you're His creation.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
So, yes.
You should tell the story about the keyboard player that played one note.
Oh, okay.
That
so
was an awesome story.
Brent.
Brent.
We all know Brent in spirit. We talk about him around here.
So Brent was a 6'5" burly guy, covered from head to toe in tattoos. Was a drug dealer. I think he might have murdered somebody.
And went to jail.
But anyway, he was completely delivered and came to our church. He just flew in and flopped on the floor, and it's like, here's Brent. And he was the most loving guy, and he just wanted to please God. He may not have done it right all the time, but he really did. He just wanted to be with the Lord. And so he, we were having meetings every night, so he's like, well, I'm going to come in the morning, and I'm going to have my meetings in the morning. And so he would sit there and just, is your keyboard still on? Is your keyboard still on?
Yeah.
He would go like this. Thank you, Lord. So, and I do want to, there's one thing that this in my worship, whatever, journey, I've always thought about this. Have y'all heard of Don Potter?
Yes.
Does anybody know? He's, I think he's related to Morningstar Ministries, and he's a very powerful prophetic singer.
Yeah.
And I heard a story once, and he made a whole album called Facing the Wall. And it was basically, I'm going to just read the quote. It said, I've spent many years trying to entertain people and later lead them into the praise of the Lord Jesus. In the middle of leading praise one day, I believe I heard the Lord say, go home and play until you discern my presence.
Hallelujah.
I did this by facing the wall and playing the guitar. At first, I could only play a few minutes before the desire to entertain crept back in. After a year, I could play for hours and never realize that it happened. The pleasure of the Lord was better than any reward I had ever received.
Mm.
And when I heard that for the first time, it was like, all I could think about was, Lord, do not take your presence from me. Do not take your spirit from me.
Mm.
You know, because I know I don't ever want to be in a place where my pride has gotten in the way and all I want to do is entertain.
Yes.
It is so important that I know that I am coming up here because I am broken and because I need Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
And because I know that He's going to meet me, and it really is the audience of one. He's the only person that I'm here to talk to.
Mm-hmm.
And if you get ministered to, then that's great. But know that the reason that I'm here is because I want to meet with my God.
Mm-hmm.
And you should want to meet with your God as well.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, I was going to say, Ray and I, obviously we're in the same church. And, I can't sing at all. I don't have any musical talents.
Amen.
But I would. But I'll do it personally.
I love you.
And, I think all of us need to be worshipers.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
I mean, in your own place. And there was times when I was in Guatemala, I would spend 4 hours just dancing before the Lord. I can't dance either. But I was just doing it. And it was expressing my heart.
Mm-hmm.
So I've always, I got to a place where two things happened at this other church. It's really the story of David and Goliath, to be honest with you.
Mm-hmm.
And, what she's talking about is more like David, whereas, you know, the contrast to Goliath, you know, the stature of the world,
mm-hmm.
right?
Good. Mm-hmm.
And it got to the point where I was so hungry to worship God and be in the presence of God that we were going to these meetings before we met Pastor Rick, and I would be seeking just one song somebody would play where it was anointed and it was the true presence of God coming, mm-hmm. in comparative to the very professional, accurate, right. musically accurate mm-hmm. worship that we had at our church. I mean, this guy even had it down to where you had to sway a certain way in the choir and you would get reprimanded if you did it. And he made t-shirts with this on it. And it was musically perfect, you know. And every once in a while, the presence of God would come. And like Rita said, you know, the pastor would get up there and just explain it all, and everything would stop. But when you start, you know, I started to crave that. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we moved on, right? We moved on and we did it in the right way. And we God used that place in our lives, so it mm-hmm. wasn't all bad.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I got to the Oasis, I realized you could just have that every time.
Mm-hmm.
And so we are 2-3 years in. We go back for some function. And I sat in the back of the church, and they were worshiping with this man that Raina was referring to. And I literally saw the people. They weren't worshiping God. They were attracted to this music.
Mm-hmm.
And they were raising their hands, and you
yep.
saw it happen.
Mm-hmm.
And it was so sickening. I literally had to walk out mm-hmm. of the sanctuary because
mm-hmm.
I was about to weep.
Mm-hmm.
And so my point is, that was a very important lesson for me on many different fronts. Number one, you know, I realized what the value of the presence of God. And number two, I realized that whatever you do in that setting as a leader in God's body, you'll attract people. People will come and
mm-hmm.
gather
mm-hmm.
around anything.
Mm-hmm.
People gather around, you know, picket lines. People gather around the presence of God. People gather around political causes. People are just naturally going to gather around causes. So people were there. There were 1,700 members in that church, and they were there for what was given to them. And then, but when you decide that you're only going to invite the presence of God and a bunch of broken people get together and worship God in everything they do, like song, preaching,
mm-hmm.
praying, all of that,
mm-hmm.
you know, the numbers might not be there, but the presence of God will, and those who come will truly be changed.
Amen.
And they'll be attracted to that presence.
Yes.
Whereas, you know, in this other place, people used to come in to worship all the time, and our senior pastor loved it.
Mm-hmm.
He loved that perfect music.
Mm.
And he just thrived on it, and he just, you know, loved that, and it just... And then it was funny because at the same time that when I started off talking about my testimony on the first night, if those of you that were here, that one of those meetings, Raina's mom was worshiping and the presence of God came. And then that prophetic word that literally changed my life happened in that setting. And it was like a Wednesday morning service they used to have there. It was completely different than the whole thing. And her dad was... you know, he was in charge of it, so he would preach and he would conduct the service. So, but it's, you know, whatever you're putting out there, people will come. It doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
But it's, you know, if you put the pure thing out there,
mm-hmm.
God brings in those people and true change happens.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So,
I want to say that I don't know if y'all realize just how blessed you are to be here, because last night, I just mean everybody that comes up here and worships,
mm-hmm.
and they're entering in, and they're so excited about the worship, because you go to some places and people are just sitting there
mm-hmm.
like this,
mm-hmm.
and people are like, oh, don't judge them, you don't know, and I'm like, well, how can you be standing in front of the Almighty God
yes.
and not
Amen.
Want to raise your hands and sing out with everything that you have. And that's, I love coming here because people are just ready. They know that God is going to be here. And I mean, I was sitting out there when y'all were doing pre-service and I was talking to Ken, and I think the presence of God was like strong out there, and I was not even in here. So I was like, dang, if it's like that out there, there's no telling what it's like inside. So y'all are very fortunate and very blessed to be. Even that you don't have live music, it doesn't matter.
Mm-mm.
It's all about your heart. It's all about your heart.
Mm-hmm.
So, any other questions? Even if it's something that we haven't even talked about, if you have a question about something.
I just want to say it's super refreshing to hear you say, like, I'm a hot mess, and and I just get into it because that's my responsibility in the Lord, because that's my everyday.
Yeah.
Every moment. It's just a mess, but God is in it.
Yes,
right, and I can't take any credit for it, which is the plan, right?
Right.
Amen.
It's all Him. So.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
And when you said you were, when you go through trouble times, that's when you need
Him. Amen.
Mm-hmm. And the same, and be alone, and let Him build you back up.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Mm-hmm.
So, and it's good that He knows already what's in my heart. But He doesn't care that I'm just complaining or that He wants to hear what I have to say.
Mm-hmm.
Because He is the lover of my soul.
Amen. So I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
And I know Jeff addressed part of this yesterday as he was the word, bringing forth what God had for the church. But in worship, you know, I talk a lot about, you know, not being jealous and envious. Okay. And God keeps it in the forefront of our minds here at River of Life. Because that will destroy a church quickly. It will hurt praise and worship. And so as a worshiper, being on different places in worship, I know you've encountered that.
Yeah.
And so if you could just maybe hit on that a little bit, because again, that it will help people, because we know we're not all supposed to be the same.
Right.
But even in this setting, it's different than what I go through as a minister of the gospel. Compared to what you go through in worship, it's the same, but it's still different. If you could just hit on that a little bit.
Okay. I will say, you know, I don't want to call it a religious church because I really did, I grew up in that church, and I have a lot of great memories in that church, and it was my home for a very long time, but it's just a completely different revelation. But, you know, there was a girl there who, I mean, she just was so much better than me. And or just anybody, there was a lot of people, and I would look at that and be like, God, why can't I be like them so that I can be where I think I'm supposed to be?
Mm-hmm.
And it was like, why are they getting this opportunity and I'm not getting it?
Mm-hmm.
And so that's envy, that's jealousy, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I just had to come to a place where I knew that the Lord is, if your heart is towards God and you are trying to do your best to go on the path that He's chosen for you, then you are confident and know that He is going to put you right where He wants you.
Amen.
And He's going to give you the opportunities that He wants you to have.
Mm-hmm.
So it took me, I've been there for 10 years, I'm 33, so I was like 25, 26, 27 before, and that's young to some people, you know, but to me that's like, 27 years before God put me in a place where I started to feel like I was fulfilling my calling. And then I still, even now, battle like, I'm getting old, and I'm not getting old, but I just feel that way, you know? Because I'm like, I'm getting old, and I'm not doing half of what I thought I was supposed to do, but then it's like, no. Because God put me right where He wanted me to be to minister to the people that He knew would get from what I'm giving.
Yes.
Would receive from what I'm giving. And so it wouldn't, I could, and I mean, I know that I'm no Amy Grant or Sandy Patty, that's okay. I don't have to be those people. Like, I don't have to be, but it's like, even if I was put into that position, it wouldn't be right.
Mm.
So I would be fighting against the will of God, and I would have no joy in my life because I
Amen.
Wasn't doing what I was supposed to be doing. So being envious and jealous is not going to get you anywhere because it's not putting you where God wants you to be.
Yes.
And it's okay that I lead worship for a congregation of 10 people.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter because it's going back. It's going back to
our numbers are up.
All that matters is that I'm here to meet with God.
Yes.
All that matters is that I'm there for the one-on-one with the Lord, and I know that He will minister to people out of out of that. And there was even a time that we were going through some serious stuff on the worship team, and as the worship leader, I was like, hey, Pastor Rick, I think you need to handle this, because I didn't know how to handle it.
Sure.
I didn't know what to do. And so, you know, really the Lord just had me be quiet and not say anything, because there was a lot of times that I sat down at my computer and I typed up 3 pages of stuff I was going to say, and then I deleted it.
Amen.
And he just had me be quiet, because then he removed those people from the situation. Yep. But it was like at that moment, I told the Lord, you can take the worship leader away from me. It's okay, because I know that I'm still being obedient. I don't have to be a worship leader to minister to people.
Right.
I don't have to have that title. I said, you can take it from me. And I had reached that point where I wasn't envious and jealous anymore of anybody or where they were, because I was sitting right in God's will. I was sitting right in it, and you know that you're supposed to be there, and you are content.
Peace.
You are, yes, peace. I was at peace, and I said, it's okay, God. If you want to take this from me, and they want that so bad, if they want it so bad, you give it to them. It's okay. I'm not going to be hurt. I'm not going to be upset, because what I have with you is far above and beyond anything that can be given to me.
That's good.
Amen. That answer your question?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, that was good.
And I think with envy and jealousy as well, it gets to a point in all of our lives where you're kind of like Peter, right, when he got filled with the Holy Spirit in the upper room in Acts, and he comes out, and I always envisioned him, you know, they were really mocking them and saying, oh, they're just drunk and all this, and he just... It's not that he wanted to make a public display or speak out and be noticed. He could not be quiet at that point.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he wasn't thinking about look at me or any of these things. The Spirit of God himself pushed him in front of all those people, and he delivered a message that he probably didn't know he could deliver.
Mm-hmm.
From a place of brokenness.
Amen.
and passion. And at the end of that message, people said, what do we need to do to be saved?
Mm-hmm.
So when you have that type of purpose and God brings you to that place, and everybody has to get there, it's a long, windy road of being broken,
right,
and pressed down and destroyed.
Mm-hmm.
And then you get to the point where you can't be quiet.
Mm-hmm.
And then when you're at that point and you're coming from that perspective, mm-hmm, you're not even really thinking about blessing people or doing any of that. You have to say what God, mm-hmm, put on your heart. You just can't keep it contained.
Mm-hmm.
And no matter if you're worshiping through music or you're preaching or you're sharing anywhere,
mm-hmm,
and you know, that's when you start to see not only... Sometimes I try to determine if I'm changing more or the people that I'm talking to are changing more, because it changes me.
It does.
In that, mm-hmm, moment. And it, you know, about every time Pastor Rick asks me to preach at the church, we don't talk very much often. I like it that way, because we're more connected in the spirit from my perspective. And then we get these times where we're close together and we, you know, we get to talk about the Lord in person. But every time you text me, I'm always going through something. And I get up there, just like Raina was describing, how she gets to Sunday and it's been the worst week.
Mm-hmm.
But that's when it usually is the best, because I'm so desperate for God in that period of, mm-hmm, time. Mm-hmm. And even coming here, I had a bunch of things in my life going on during the day even.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, Thursday night when I came in here, I wanted to sit in the back, and I needed to figure out how I could compartmentalize some of these things, because I was just so ate up with things. But out of that place, God, the brokenness is the key.
Mm-hmm. It is.
Because in that place of brokenness, like David did, you're crying out from the depth,
yes,
of where your, yes, spirit is connected to God's spirit. Mm-hmm. And whatever you're doing in that moment, whether you're preaching or you're singing or playing an instrument, it's the reality. It really displays the oneness we have with God. It's the true manifestation of heaven and earth colliding. We being earth, and heaven being what it is, and the Spirit of God in us, that is our connection to heaven, just colliding and manifesting in mm-hmm. front of us.
Good.
That's good what you just said, the deep. Because in Psalms 42, it talks about deep calleth unto deep. When we're so deeply in the situation, and the aggravation, frustration, what we're at, that's when we begin to dig deep into the wealth of God and the riches of God.
We have to
begin to seek. Mm-hmm. And David said right here, I already had it right here, believe it or not, Psalm 42. Read the whole Psalm sometime soon. It's good. But it's everything she said and what he just said. David says, "Why are you so cast down, O my soul? Why are you so disquieted within me? Hope thou in God, for I shall yet praise him, who is the mm-hmm. health of my countenance and my God."
Amen.
You press through.
Mm-hmm.
That's
Amen.
Calling to the deep, the deepest, yes. deepest of God.
Yeah, if you want to be in ministry, you're going to have to need God like you've never needed
That's
him before.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So that means you're going to have to go through things that mm-hmm. others wouldn't mm-hmm. accept.
Mm-hmm.
The suffering, the trials, the tribulations. Mm-hmm. And then from that place, because people think they can study their way in.
Mm-hmm.
and they can learn their way in. The only true posture before God for ministry is you get to a place where your need for God grows deeper and deeper, because with what you start to face, there's only one way out, and
mm-hmm.
that's through the Lord or maybe some other way. And
mm-hmm.
the pressure that comes with that, like Paul described, you know, we're pressed at all sides, but we're not broken, and it forces us to cling to the Father.
Mm-hmm.
And then from that place, you're not worried about who's, you know, ministering or not ministering. You're just trying to connect with God.
Yeah.
I think that people have a tendency to say, look at all the stuff that's wrong in my life, and they think that they're wrong
mm-hmm.
or that they're in sin. But it's not, because those are the things that are drawing you to the Father.
Mm-hmm.
So you're not wrong because you're going through a hard time, and you're not
right.
out of sync with the Lord because you're going through a hard time. It's those times that he's drawing you to himself.
Amen.
So.
Amen.
And the other thing, I can't stop talking about the church. You know, with where we're at the Oasis, and even here I feel the same way. When I come in, I'm so eager to just be connected in the fellowship of the believers
mm-hmm.
because I draw so much strength from that just
mm-hmm.
to go through my own personal life. But then what's interesting is if some of you have heard, you know, the ministry of Chile,
mm-hmm.
and I know Pastor Rick agrees with me, he's vitally connected to us.
Mm-hmm.
And so he draws strength from us through the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
And then it's funny, the first time I went to Chile and all these wonderful things were happening, I was like, wait, this is all the stuff that we collectively talked about in the meetings that we had prior to him going.
Mm-hmm.
And thousands and hundreds of thousands, well, maybe at this point hundreds of thousands, but just mm-hmm. hundreds of people in these meetings. And he's just saying the same thing that we would be in a setting like this talking about.
Mm-hmm.
And it just moves like
mm-hmm.
masses.
Mm-hmm.
People are getting healed. And, you know, we're talking about this morning. People, a lot of times, they're getting healed and saved without any prayer lines.
Right.
They're just.
It's the presence of the Lord.
The presence of the Lord did it.
Mm-hmm.
And it was from the times where we were in these intimate settings or we're in our, you know, fellowshipping, and the Lord just starts to minister to us. And then we just take the same thing and put it over
mm-hmm.
there.
Raina, we had a guy, of course he wasn't from here, but during worship, you know, because our worship's different, but during worship, he was sitting right over here by the corner, and he wasn't a believer, but he came, and all of a sudden he's looking up, and the ceiling moved. It removed, a hole opened up in the ceiling, and he seen heaven, and he just fell apart right where he was sitting. And he received Christ right there on the spot. And it was during the worship.
Mm-hmm.
And so one of the things, of course, it's different here. We don't have live worship. But the worship's highly anointed because we have to hear God for what songs we're supposed to sing and how long. But I try to pick ones that go into instrumental. And I'm trying to get the people in the media to to listen for the person with the microphone as they start to move in the prophetic, so that they turn that music down so that God can start to move, because I know that he wants to, and that's one of the reasons that I wanted you to speak. But because of our setting, it's different. But I know it happens in live too.
Yeah.
You can get rubbed by other people. They're off tune. They should know better. The music's too loud. I'm not going to sing. I've had enough. And this goes with what Jeff was preaching last night. It has to become about other people and our focus with God. Can you just address that a little bit? Because we've got to be able to get past these technical issues and problems and personality problems, because it should all be about God.
Yeah. For me, if I get distracted, I just have to pull myself back.
Mm-hmm.
I just have to, okay, oh gosh, why is she playing that? We're not even there. But if I just forget about it and just, it's not a worry anymore, it always works itself out if I just stop. Because at that point, it's you that's causing the problem and not the other person.
So do you stop doing what you're doing? Do you stop playing? Do you walk away? Or do you just take control of this?
I think it just depends, because I'm not a strong guitar player. Like, I know you may not see that, but it's like a lot of people can, like Rick, I can just start singing and he can just start playing with me. And he just picks the key and he knows the chords that I'm singing, and I cannot do that. So people will, like, I'll get lost in my 4-chord that I'm supposed to be playing, and so I do literally have to stop.
Mm-hmm.
Or I just stop playing altogether because I know they're carrying it. So
mm-hmm.
I just stop and I just put my focus back on the Lord,
mm-hmm.
and I just keep going.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not stopping because I'm angry. I'm just stopping because I'm not going to let that be a hindrance to me.
Good.
So, or I just listen a minute, I figure out where we are, and I keep playing again. Because when you're trying to be in the Spirit, it's so, like, it becomes just my fingers are remembering because I'm not remembering where we're playing. Because, like, last night I was doing the prophetic thing, and I kept opening my eye and be like, oh, I'm supposed to be playing C. And I would, like, keep singing because the Lord, he's not hindered by that stuff. She's not stopped by that stuff. Unless, you let it. You let it. So, it really is about just taking control of your thoughts. Being like, okay, Lord, just get me back with you.
Yes.
You just take a minute. And I wouldn't even, people are going to mess up and they're not doing it on purpose.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Right? Okay? So even if I think I heard last night that there was just nothing playing. And it was just silence.
Mm-hmm.
So if God's given you something, jump in. Because, and it's like...
During pre-service, you mean? When silent for a long time.
I just heard silence for a minute.
Mm-hmm.
And that was, you don't have to... That's another thing that I haven't talked to our team about. Is like, there's sometimes when there's no music playing, and I just start singing, and everybody tries to figure out why. And I'm just like, no, don't play anything. Just let me sing to the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And it's okay not to have music behind you. Just let's... Because other people will fill in,
mm-hmm.
And they'll get it too. So it's okay not to have the music, because that's not like you sang last night.
Mm-hmm.
And that was, Jeff said, that's it. That's what we were waiting for. You didn't need music.
Mm-mm.
You didn't need anything. You just sang.
Mm-hmm.
And it was anointed because that's what the Lord had spoken to you, and you were obedient.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the other thing that I wanted to say, is that worship, you have to be vulnerable.
Mm-hmm.
Because I can look at the people who are sitting there with their arms crossed, and they don't want to get personal with God.
Mm-hmm.
They don't, it's like he already knows your heart, but they don't want to let him in for whatever reason. So they're going to not be vulnerable, and you have to be for the worship to be true.
Amen.
You have to be. Mm-hmm. So I don't think don't let things stop you. And if you have to move away from it, move away from it.
Mm-hmm.
But don't let it, don't make that stop your entire worship set right there because someone did something wrong.
And I just want to comment, like, in the audience, from that perspective, we don't have it so much right now, but probably for about a couple years, we leave tambourines in the back and then other instruments, and people will pick these instruments up, and it will not be anywhere near the music. Mm-hmm. Like, we had one lady.
We've got that sometimes.
Yeah, she had
we
these.
We did hide them, actually.
She had this, like, this bell thing. Like, you're supposed to hold it like this and hit it. And she would just get it up and say, "Thank you, Jesus," and, like, shake it. Now.
That's the, I have something to say on that.
But we allowed it because we knew that she was expressing her heart
sure.
to God. But there's other people that come in, and we would have, like, right when I came there, we had this lady that would get up in front and dance. Mm-hmm. And it was just not right. Mm-hmm. And so we had to address her. Mm-hmm. So I think even in the audience, as the worship is being expressed, there's sometimes where it feels like it's, you know, it, technically it's a distraction, but mm-hmm. if the heart's pure, mm-hmm. you know, and it's not hurting somebody. Mm-hmm.
You know the difference.
You know the difference.
Yeah, because I've had people here, and because we jump, we move, we are whatever God, you know, and you know that. But I've had people come in, and they draw attention to themselves.
Yeah.
And so then I address that. I just go up there and I let them know that's not okay, you know, because, I mean, we're taught not to do that because it's really about the Lord. But sometimes, like you would say, if it's out of innocence, you know, we know how to handle that as leaders. And then other times you just know that it's different. They're up there for a reason. And so, yeah, and that can be distracting.
Yeah, and I just want to say that it's so important to not be led by your flesh.
Yes.
And be led by the Spirit, because that's what
quenches the Spirit.
Yeah, that's what quenches the Spirit is the flesh. And so, if, anyway, that's what I was thinking about when you said that.
Mm-hmm.
But I just, and I know you were saying you want to give people opportunity to say, you know, to do stuff during the time where there's just the music playing, and not to be, well, what if it's wrong? You know, mm-hmm. even if it is wrong, if your heart's right, that's mm-hmm. how you learn,
mm-hmm.
you know. So just be open and be, as long as you're not walking in the flesh, you know, just knowing that, okay, I need to just take a step out, because sometimes it's that first step out that breaks the ice mm-hmm. for you to continue to walk in that mm-hmm. prophetic, because it's not easy. And I mean, it took me a while of singing little things. You know, until I began to recognize, okay, this is what the Lord is saying right now, and I need to sing it. And it wasn't like this overnight, like it happened in a week. It took time, it mm-hmm. took months, it took years. And the other part of that too was that I was, the other girl that was singing with me that would do prophetic, her prophetic was way different than mine.
Mm-hmm.
And so I would hear stuff from the Lord, but she would be talking about, and the heavens are open, and the Lord and the train of his temple is coming. And I was just like, I'm here sitting, the Lord is saying, rise up and be, you know, strong. And I'm like, that had nothing to do with what she was saying. So I thought I was wrong
mm-hmm.
because she was singing something completely different.
Mm-hmm.
But that's not it.
Right.
So don't let what someone else is singing hinder you from singing what you know that God is telling you to sing. Okay.
Yeah, and in the prophetic, sometimes you only get one, like, picture or one word. Mm-hmm. And we had this man in the church. He's like, I can only prophesy one word. And he would just prophesy one word.
Mm-hmm.
But once you start speaking, once you just start to share what God has shown you, whether it's a mental picture or just one word, then you'll be surprised. Sometimes it'll just open up.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, and I think that is it for me, too, is like, it's just one word for me, or like just one little saying. So I just sing that. And like I said before, then the rest of it just starts coming mm-hmm. because I was obedient just to open my mouth for that
right,
one little
right.
thing. And then the Lord began to download everything else that he wanted to say. And a lot of times you just get started, and then before you know it, you've said all this stuff and you didn't even know that wait, what did I just sing?
Mm-hmm.
I don't even remember
mm-hmm.
because you just allowed your mind to stop working and your heart to start working.
Yes, amen.
And it just went. You had a question, go ahead.
Well, I just wanted to say, I believe that as you were saying, a lot of it comes from brokenness and from a sincere heart, but I believe it starts at home. It starts with your one-on-one with the Lord.
And that's, I mean, it's that intimacy that you have with the Lord that that's outside of the church, outside of the sanctuary, because we are the church, and
mm-hmm.
and it starts there. And I believe that the more time we are intimate in our alone time, not just reading the Bible or reading the Word or spending a little bit of time in prayer, but really deep, calling to deep, that that's where I believe a lot of that stuff is birthed,
mm-hmm.
and it begins to grow. And I know for my own self that when I get that time before I come before the body, that I'm much more empowered and more free in the spirit to be obedient and know that it is the Lord rather than myself.
Mm-hmm.
It starts at home.
I want to say that, I mean, obviously the amount of time you spend before the Lord is going to affect, you know, what comes out of you. But for me, standing up here leading worship is no different than my time at home.
Right.
I do it exactly the same here
yep.
as I do it on my living room floor.
Yep.
Or because like I say, I just, I don't even see you guys.
Mm-hmm.
Because
mm-hmm.
it's just me and God. And I think it doesn't matter where you are.
See, and the thing that you're doing, which is awesome, is that he's with us all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you're up there, you're in his presence, period. We're all here and we're thinking it's, oh, yay, there, you know, we're going to do this. But it's not. You tune us all out
mm-hmm.
and you're there with God.
Mm-hmm.
And that is your intimate time as well,
yeah.
you know, as well as in the car or at home. And that's, mm-hmm. you know, and then it becomes, you are communing with the Holy Spirit and you just keep going.
Yeah.
And you know when he lifts, it's like, okay, we're,
yeah.
it's time.
Yeah. And I think a lot of it too is that I don't try to put boundaries on my time with God, because I know like you with the young children, you know that you may not have more than 10 minutes. So I always feel like my heart is in an attitude of prayer with the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
So even if I'm like grabbing groceries and I'm like, oh God, I love you a lot. I do. Or just, God, why is my day so bad? And it's just the one little sentence of my one little connection with him.
Mm-hmm.
And it's enough because he knows that
mm-hmm.
I'm just making that moment with him. So, you know, and I just bring that wherever I go.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, go ahead.
The question was, is when you were singing and this other gal had singing in the spirit,
mm-hmm.
and but you had a different one. Did you wait until, did you continue after she was done, or did you just let it go?
Well, it took me some time to learn that I just needed to just say what I had to say.
Okay.
And so I did let her finish, you know, but then, and I would wait and then I would go. But,
mm-hmm.
you know, there was in the beginning the times that I didn't release what I had because I thought, well, maybe I'm not hearing right,
mm-hmm.
you know. But now I recognize that I was hearing right, and I should have just said, because you are sitting there dealing with something completely different than what you're dealing
right,
with.
Right.
So maybe what she was singing is ministering to you, but what I have is what's going to minister to
yes.
you.
Yes.
So it's okay that it's two separate different
yes.
things.
And see, now that was Jeff's message Monday night. Thursday night. That was his message. He said, you go ahead and do this. God bless you if you'll wait.
Mm-hmm.
You see? She waited,
mm-hmm.
and through that waiting, look what it's produced.
Mm-hmm.
See, knowing that, oh yeah, the people will be blessed because somebody needs to hear the heavens open up, because there's a certain levels of maturity. Because she waited, see, you know, she waited for it, and now
mm-hmm.
you see what's flowing out of her. And the other person, I know that person for many years, and they're still saying the same thing.
Yeah.
Which is blessing the people, you know,
mm-hmm.
that need that kind of blessing.
Mm-hmm.
But then you got somebody speaking much deeper things
mm-hmm.
now because she waited.
Mm-hmm.
So that was your word, waiting.
Amen.
And the other thing, too, I was just thinking, hold on, I got to get it back, is something that Jeff said to me was that when you have a gift like this, You can turn it on and off. Mm-hmm. So I can get up there right now and just start playing, and I could come up with something. But that doesn't mean that it's right mm-hmm. for the time. Mm-hmm. So, you know, just be conscious of that. Like, it's easy to turn things on and off and, you know, and give it, but just make sure that you really are, like I said, not being in the flesh and being in the spirit. Because even Jeff said it last night, I can prophesy anytime I want to, but that doesn't mean that it's the right time.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
You know, so.
Amen.
I think sometimes people try to replicate a move that God had already did, maybe with a song or with a special word or whatever, and then they try to get that, and God really moved with at that moment, at that time, and then they try to do it again.
Yes.
And it's not got the same effect.
Yes, I do run across that a lot because, well, you know, you do the same songs over and over again. And so it's easy for me to be like, oh, when we did this song and the Lord gave me these words, maybe I should sing it again because it was really powerful. And then we try to do it again and it is dry as cracker juice.
Yeah.
It is not it. It's like, so yeah, just being okay with maybe he's going to give you something, maybe he's not. But don't feel like you have to do the same things over and over and over again. Mm-hmm. Be okay with the new mm-hmm. songs. Mm-hmm. So, but at times, there are things that every single time I do it this way, the Lord falls. So I know that it's okay to do it the same then mm-hmm. because there's power in it. Mm-hmm. And it always changes lives and mm-hmm. it's good. Mm-hmm. So at that time, I'm not afraid mm-hmm. to do it the same.
But and one of the things that, like for us, because we have to pick and choose our music, mm-hmm. and God will, the Holy Spirit, I don't even know the lyrics, but I'll hear it, and the Lord will say, go get it. And I get that, and I bring it to the church, and we'll play it for, until the Lord says, don't play it anymore. And normally it's a few weeks because we learn it, and but then people can, and you see the results because you're here. And a lot of times I get a lot of music that is sent to me, and it's great and I love it, but I might not play it for 6 months
yes.
because all of a sudden God will say, like the communion song that Shane or Shay sent, that was six months before I ever, and the one the Lord said, and I didn't even remember any about it, but God said that to now. Mm-hmm. And the thing is just like, preaching, we don't know who's going to come in that door. We might know Vivian and we might know Patricia, but we don't know what they're dealing with or what's going on. And so even, you know, with worship, you have to wait on the Lord so yes. that you are getting the right stuff at the right time, because otherwise, if we play what we like, it is dead.
Yeah.
And sometimes even like God will say, I'll be unsure. Am I supposed to, you know, are we done with this song? Normally I'm pretty sure, but sometimes I'm not real sure because I like it too. And I see the results, but yet, and if I do play it, I can tell, okay, we're done with that. That song's out of season.
Right.
And so even for what we do here, and the other thing God has done here is I only have a couple microphones, but I put them in hands of people. But I've also recently told Shelly, I said, Shelly, if God chose you to put that in somebody else's hands, I want you to do that because the Lord said she'll know, you know. So I've released her to do that because, you know, there's other people in this church. And every time they sing with the songs that we sing, it's added. There's an added anointing to it. It does something. And we used to never have that. But all of a sudden, the Lord said, start doing that. And so if they sing with it and you can hear them, it adds to it. It doesn't have to be like they're singing. It just adds to it. It's the craziest thing what God does with worship. But like the results is somebody seeing heaven sitting in a chair who'd never experienced God before. You know, and I want to add when Thursday night when you guys started your worship, and I was in the back, and I love to be back there and to serve. And so that's my place right now because, but yet God showed me stuff in the back, and I'm in the back anyways, but I watched you, Raina, worshiping God and leading, and I watched the people, you know, And I just seen this huge thing happening in the spirit, you know, because of your obedience and because of everything that you're sharing with everybody here. And like Jeff said, you can't take shortcuts. You can't just get there.
Yeah.
You know, you got to go through the trials and the tribulations, and we have to get over ourselves, and we have to not be jealous and envious. And we're robbing from the body if we don't allow God to place us where we need to be and be content there without wanting to do what Dave does. Mm-hmm. You know, because it's, you know, so I was watching that in the back there, but seeing things in the spirit, and it was just amazing. And so even when I was trying to catch, I finally, like, said, we're going live, because the words, the prophetic words that were coming forth yesterday were super anointed, you know. But again, I like how you explained that. Your heart was in the right place.
Yeah.
And you didn't just start out that way. You worshiped. You were in communion with him, and then they came. Mm-hmm. And they were for us, everybody that was here last night, you know. And then whatever I could get out there, you know, but my battery starts to die with y'all, so I got time just right.
I do want to say, too, not everybody may see it this way, but I do. I just feel like the way we worship the Lord is like our signature to him. Like, he recognizes us by how we worship him.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like each person has a different fragrance.
Mm-hmm.
And so he'll start to smell and be like, oh, she's worshiping me again, you know? And so it's like, not everybody is the same, and not everybody can be the same.
Right.
You know, because you have to be that different fragrance to the Lord, because you're special to him, just you.
Amen.
So know that the Lord recognizes you by how you praise him, and that he gave you that way to praise because it's special to him,
mm-hmm.
and that it's good.
Mm-hmm.
So,
I think he's also going to give you that moments where that which you're going to praise differently.
Mm-hmm.
Because last night, Pastor, I walked in and Pastor handed me a tambourine. Said, "Here, go lead them." And I was like, "Okay." So, like, we got the tambourine. I came up and I just, bleh, I forgot who
Free
I
service.
Was, forgot where I was, and just
went
all out.
Yep.
I mean, Brittany walked in, she's like, I walk in, I see you out there doing jumping jacks with a tambourine.
It was anointed.
It was.
And our pre-service is called by God, and we've done it for years. And but he's evolving it, and I do believe the day is coming where you'll come into the church, pre-service will still be going on. And it's like you guys worship, you know, for an hour and a half. And Oasis, and we don't do that here, but we do that here, just in a different form.
Right.
And so our pre-service has a lot of people in it for the majority because we're hungry. We wanna, you know, and then we get another dose of it. But I do believe that there'll be a day in the future, and I think he's been preparing us, educating us, teaching us, purifying our hearts, so that there'll be a day where, you know, at 10 o'clock we're in here for pre-service and people end up coming in for service and we just keep going.
Yeah.
And I do believe that. And I believe he's preparing us for that.
Mm-hmm.
So, because it's hard to stop even pre-service.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, and sometimes where people are coming in for service and then they just join in. So, and then we have to shut down and pull everything together because we didn't get anything done. But God has showed me that we're not coming in to set up the church, we're coming in to set up the atmosphere. So I don't want anybody filling the cleaning bathrooms or getting mints out, you know. We try to be at the end and be ready because it's important that he's sending people here. We're here. He sent us here first to get things ready, to get our hearts ready so that he can move through us. And it's only growing.
Yeah.
So, yeah. And I just got to say this about Raina, and I'm going to step out on a limb here, and I don't know if you can do this tonight or tomorrow, but probably tomorrow because we already did tonight's song, but favorite one.
Okay. Sure.
Favorite one. That first time I ever heard that, I heard it live from them, and we've sang it a few times, but nothing like, I could maybe do that.
I can do that. What was the other one you asked me about too? Okay, yeah.
King of Glory. Mm-hmm. Okay. So.
I can do it.
Good.
Mm. I'd like to show a small thing, a visual, if I could. Because what she's talking about, what we're all talking, I'm assuming that every one of you are understanding now that you are ministers. You are ministers.
Hallelujah.
You may not be in the pastor's shoes right now, but you're ministers. You're called to pastor people. You're called to evangelize in Christ's name. You're called to prophesy. You're called to do all these gifts because the spirit of the gifts is within you.
Right.
Never limit him. Never limit him. Jeff mentioned a while ago about a person that says, God gives me one word. Well, the truth is, that's where his faith is. It's in one word. Mm-hmm. See, because God gives you much, not just one word, but that person is comfortable in the one word, but now he's understanding, so don't think different. Because now he's beginning to grow. I spoke with him one day. It's like Moses. Moses was told to strike the rock and the water came forth. Told by God to strike the rock twice. The third time, the Lord said, speak to the rock. He strikes the rock. So he's still in the same place. In the same place. Now, true worship is obedience. And obedience is we think, okay, I'm not doing this, I'm not doing that. I just do some obedient. It goes much deeper than that. If you're in the fellowship, and the Lord's given you a word to speak, and you don't speak it, what's happening? See, you're limiting what God wants to do. Because he won't speak to the whole body. Isn't that the message you've been hearing? It's the body. Did you know, I'm going a little further, I'm sorry. But did you know that there's actually a place that tells us what our ministry is? What our true ministry is. And it is for the edifying, listen, of the body of Christ. It tells you in Ephesians chapter 4. That's your true ministry. Edifying and building up one another. How do you do that? By obedience. As we're led by the Spirit of God. You see, I'm not leading him. Say, God, with me, Lord, this is what I want to do today.
Right.
He's leading me. And the only way to be led is exactly what Jeff read last night, Ephesians chapter 4. It said, until we all come into the fullness, into the perfection of the fullness of the Lord Jesus, of the stature of the Lord Jesus Christ. What's your idea of how tall he is? How tall do you think he is? Now, if you believe that the Shroud of Turin is real, then he's about 5'11 to 6 feet. I mean, they've measured it. They said that's how tall he was. But you see, they're looking at the natural man. Mm-hmm. They're not looking at Christ, the anointing, the Messiah, that one. I want to give you a visual. Because if you truly want to minister, and you want to edify this body, and you want to truly bring people to Christ himself and not to yourself, then we must be conformed to his image, to his stature, his very stature. Do you know how tall he is? I'll show you what his stature is. Do you want to see what his stature is? Do you really want to see the stature of our Lord? Because if you, well, I'll show you. This is how tall he is. Because he'd never done anything that the Father didn't instruct.
Hallelujah.
Never said anything the Father didn't say. He was like this in the garden. He said, not my will. That is the stature of the Lord Jesus Christ. That is the place of absolute maturity. That's how you measure maturity.
Amen.
And in that place, and only in that place, do you really, truly fall in love.
Yeah.
Because as long as you're standing, you can't love.
Right.
You can't truly love. But when you're broken and humble, then you begin to understand love. How do I know that? Because Stephen, his stature, when he was being stoned, he was like this, being stoned. What happened? It says he saw the Lord Jesus Christ standing on the right-hand side of the Father. What was he doing? He was applauding. Stephen, you got it. Because he said, don't hold us to their account for it. He understood love.
Amen.
You see? So you'll never be a real minister of God. I don't care where you go to church. I don't care what truth you think you have. I don't care. You'll never be a true minister of God until you're broken. And you realize the need of your brother beside you and your sister, how much you need each other.
Amen.
Because I cannot reach that fullness without you.
That's right.
I need you. I need Pastor Joyce. I need every one of you. You're a part of my life. Jeff said it last night. I don't know if you caught it when he said it. But he said Jesus, in a sense, you know, is not perfected or complete without us. Why? Because Jesus said, I'm in you and you're in me, and together, together we shall bear much fruit. I mean, why are we called his body?
Amen. We are his body.
Yes.
He can't live without his body.
Exactly. And there are people, ministers, that will teach you, God don't have need for you. Are you kidding me? Mm-hmm. Are you kidding me? He gave us the Spirit for that very purpose. Yeah. Because there's a need. Even all those that went before us, the great matriarchs that we salute and we sing about and we just read about and think how great they were. The Scriptures tell us very plainly that without us, they will not be perfected. They're waiting on us. Come on, guys. Come on, guys. Because we complete the work.
Amen.
So you understand, the true stature is absolute surrender and obedience. And remember that obedience is not just out there on things that you did in the darkness before. You don't. No, it's in here. It's in here, too. What is the Lord saying, dude? That's the whole message this morning. And being led by the Spirit in the worship. And being led by the Spirit in the message, being led by the Spirit, letting the Spirit is abdic. Like I said earlier, respecting Him and honoring Him. Because He's the one who reveals all truth to us. So why wouldn't we respect and honor Him and not quench Him? Not insult Him. You understand what I'm saying?
Amen.
So the true stature of Jesus Christ is absolutely prostrate before Heavenly Father. Love so much. That, my friend, is worship. That's worship when you come in here. And how wonderful it is when we can begin to sing to our God how beautiful and how wonderful and how precious He is to when we sing with one voice. So, like Raina says, if I can just move out of the way, if I can just get out of the way and sing, and people not looking at me. Jeff said it this morning. So when he stood up last night, he was thinking, some way I could keep you from looking at me. I look at the wall and preach. I don't know if you know this, but you know Azusa Street, right? The great revival. Did you know James Seymour, the man who was called by God and set up by God to do that actual work? Did you know when he stood before the people and he preached, you know how he did it? He had a peach box, a peach crate. A peach crate. And when he began to speak, he would get down and put his head in that. That's how he would speak. From a peach crate. Because I didn't want people to look at him. We've had wonderful examples before. We've had awesome examples before. Christ being the ultimate example. If we just prostrate ourselves. Say, Lord, I love you so much. I mean, we do, right? We do. There's not a day that I'm not grateful to my God. Not a day that I'm not thankful. You see me joy and playing and I'm calling me Billy Bob. It's because I have the joy of the Lord. It's more than just fun in this life. This is deep down within me, even in the difficult times. I'm Billy Bob. Like David said, why are you cast down, O my soul? Why are you so disquieted within me? In other words, you can't shut up the voices. Put your hope in God.
Amen.
Praise Him is what He said. That's He's speaking to Himself. Let's get up and let's get this on.
Yep.
I'm going to talk to my God. Sometimes church don't look like they're really believers. They want somebody else to deliver them from that torment rather than getting up and shaking themselves.
Amen.
For some man to come in and light a fire mm-hmm. under them. Oh, let's have a revival so we get all rejuvenated again. You don't need revival. Mm-hmm. When you were saved and got the Holy Ghost, you were revived.
Amen.
You were revived. You came alive. You were dead before. That's what revive means, to bring something that was dead back to life. It's talking about the lost, not us. I don't need revival. Paul told Timothy, he said, son, stir up that gift within you. Stir up that gift that's within you. In other words, don't wait for me to come to stir it up. Because I'll have to keep it burning if I do that.
Mm-hmm.
You stir up the gift.
Mm-hmm.
Why are you so quiet within me? Why is all this going on in me, soul? Shut up.
Mm-hmm.
Another place he said, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Praise his holy name.
Amen.
I said more, but I want to give you a visual.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the truth.
Amen.
That's the truth. It's only you'll only be valuable in the hand of God and in a lost world when you absolutely prostrate yourself before God. Say, not my will, but you want, Lord.
Mm-hmm.
When you walk into, when you pick up your guitar, say, not me, Lord. Not my will. What do you want, Lord? Because, see, you have a gift. When you sang, and I was here the last time, I heard that voice of my God. Mm-hmm. Because there's something powerful in there. You listen to me. You're anointed.
Mm-hmm.
Like she said earlier, there's a difference between good music and anointing. Benny Hinn told a story when, you know, Benny Hinn told a story one time when he was in Canada. He was invited to do a New Year's Eve weekend thing. So on the morning service, Sunday morning service, they had this man sit up and sing, "He Touched Me." And the man was such a perfectionist, and it was so beautiful, so awesome. And he sang, "He Touched Me," and everybody, yes, amen, hallelujah, clapped and everything. And he said, and then he went on and ministered, and he said that night he come back ready, and there was a lady that was a part of the fellowship there, an elderly lady, and she missed that morning service, but she had asked the pastor, could she sing? And he said, sure, because she's such a part of the family. Like, yeah, people here, it's really you. Okay, yeah, do it. You know. And so she stood up, Benny said, and didn't know anything about the morning service. She sang, "He Touched Me," with a broken voice, way out of key. And but she just, her heart, "He touched me. Oh, he touched me." It's like me when I was called to worship. My wife said, "Are you kidding me? You can't sing." I said, "I know it. But the pastor pointed, you do it." You know, okay. Terrified. Well, this woman sang, and he said, by the time she'd been stoned, said there wasn't nobody in that building, 1,000 people, that wasn't crying and wasn't kneeling on the floor. He said he never ministered that day.
Mm-hmm.
The Holy Ghost said, well, the anointing. Because the anointing destroys every yoke.
Mm-hmm.
Entertainment. Only entertains is all it does.
Yep.
It's not the perfection, it's the heart. That's
yes.
what she said, right?
Yes.
I'm sorry. Took longer. I'm going to give you a visual.
Our very identity here is River of Life Ministry.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
We're supposed to be different.
Yes, sir. River of Life. So it's not Pastor Joyce ministry.
Right.
Not all of it.
And that's something.
Right.
It's River of Life ministry.
Yes.
And her responsibility is to draw that out of you.
Mm-hmm.
To draw it out of you. Because you're so gifted. You're so gifted. Sharon, you remember the day at Stu and Genesis out in the yard, and you came over to me at the piano and I said, "Sing with me." She's anointed.
Yeah.
She's anointed. I knew it then. You see, there's such gifts in here.
Mm-hmm.
Such gifts, and God's going to use them.
Mm-hmm. But he's breaking us so that it comes from a pure heart. Because it has to come from a pure heart or it becomes about us.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I believe this is part of the preparation of that because of the progression that I've watched God do in this body with the people. And it's pretty amazing. But it comes through brokenness. And that's why your testimony was so important. So thank you for sharing that.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.